Well, thanks very much for the introduction and thanks for inviting me to speak. It's actually not my first time in Bergen, but it's my first time for 10 years, and it's a real pleasure to be back. And thank you for laying on the London-style weather for me. Made me feel really at home. I also am really enjoying speaking in Scandinavia again. We don't have these things anywhere else in the world, so having this on is a really fun experience. I'm going to talk about the Obama campaign. I'm going to talk about the digital elements of the Obama campaign, and a little bit about the lessons that I learned from the campaign that I think are applicable everywhere in the world, not just in the States. Just to start by telling you a little bit about me, I worked for the Obama campaign, but as you can tell from my voice, I'm not actually an American. I was exposed on my first day as a foreigner just by opening my mouth. But I've been living in America for several years. I now live in New York, literally on Bergen Street in New York, but working a lot across our offices in the States and in Europe as well. My job on the campaign was much more to do with this guy. I was working in the response team, and that meant that a lot of my time was spent thinking about Mitt Romney, watching him speak, reading what he said, learning about what he had for breakfast. He was a huge part of my life, and now he's gone. you know, I miss him. I miss him. You're laughing, but you know, this has been a difficult transition for me. But you know, we were on the response team, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But really, we were trying to use digital and work alongside our incredible colleagues in research and the media team and across the digital department to respond to any of the attacks that Mitt Romney made against the president. Every time that he misled people about the president's record or what the president plan to do, we responded, but also to try and explain his background and the facts about his policies so that people could understand the choice in the election, because elections are always a choice rather than a referendum. I just want to say a couple of words about Blue State Digital. It's a company I worked for before going to the Obama campaign, and I'm now, as was mentioned, back there again. We're a digital company, which was good for my experience of going to the campaign. That we tried to use the same kind of experiences, the same kind of tactics that we had on the campaign to create change with organizations in their own organizations, or whether it's in their marketplace or in society as a union or a not-for-profit charity or a political party. And we do that across a whole range of sectors. Just a few examples of the clients that we're really proud to work with, from Vogue magazine through the Green Bay Packers to the US Holocaust Museum. The tactics that I'm going to talk about in this presentation are the same kind of tactics that we apply to our range of our clients. So I know that I'm going to talk a lot about politics. That's really all I know much about. But I know this is an audience that is thinking about how to use digital in a range of environments. And I hope that the discussion that we have, both from what I say and also the questions that you'll be asking me, will touch not just politics, but also all of our industries. So I want to start off by just talking for a second about campaigns. You know, election night last year, when the election was called, was a very emotional moment for us. I'm sure a small number of you stayed up until the middle of the night to watch the results come in. And it feels, in retrospect, very inevitable. It feels he's Barack Obama. He had $1 billion. Of course he was going to win. It was just an inevitable tide of campaigns that led to that moment. But actually, that wasn't how people thought it was going to go. Nate Silver, who is now a very well-known and impressive journalist, said that he thought that Barack Obama was most likely to end up as a one-term president. And I think that this speaks to both the... I think that part of the difference between this slide and this picture the most tweeted picture in Twitter's history. The difference between those two things partly speaks to the campaign. Campaigns matter. How we engage with the public matters. And I think that's interesting for two reasons. Firstly, it will help us understand why the lessons that we learned from the campaign are so important to apply in everything else we do. But secondly, the fact that campaigns matter is really important to people who work in campaigns. So I think both of those reasons is really important. Before we dig into those lessons, I just want to take a step back for a second and talk about what digital is for and how we saw it. To us, the role of digital was to engage the largest number possible of supporters, people who would do something for the president, people who would help him tangibly affect the outcome of the election, because the election is fundamentally about winning more votes than the other guy. And really everything else is subservient to that. And so we were trying to do three things in a campaign. The first thing we were trying to do was to communicate our message. This is an example that you can find on YouTube of a video that we made with a fake news broadcast, looking into the future, what would a Romney administration look like, to try and get people thinking about the choice that was on offer. We were trying to communicate a message about ourselves and a message about what Romney would do as president. We were trying to raise money. Elections, particularly in the States, are expensive things. Mitt Romney is a phenomenal fundraiser. And so we were trying to raise money, particularly from the largest possible number of small donors around the country. 4.4 million people gave money to the Obama campaign over the course of the campaign, so that we could do all of the other things like opening field offices around the country, putting advertisements on television, and so on. And the third thing is to mobilize people. So we have money, message, and mobilization. It's always much more impressive when you can be alliterative about these things. So we were trying to recruit people online who would turn off their computers and go and do things in the real world. Those were the three things we were trying to do, and we were trying to do them by nurturing relationships with our supporters, using the kind of lessons that I'm going to talk about through the rest of this talk. So the first one, digital is everyone's job. You know, over the history of campaigns, we have treated the internet geeks as the kids that sit in the corner and do their thing, and they watch Star Trek, and maybe they fix our printers for us as well. That was never really the right way to go, but now it is even less. Digital is something for everyone, and the role of the digital department was to support every aspect of the whole campaign. That's because people don't live their lives only online. People live and gather news and interact with each other in a very integrated way. People don't have friends they only communicate with on Facebook. They also see them. They also call them. And in that way, we tried to connect the role of digital with everything else that was going on, using what was happening on TV, using the TV advertisements, using online tactics to recruit people to go offline. And that's a challenge, to integrate digital into what everyone else is doing and to encourage everyone else across the organization to integrate into digital. And so we had to be set up to be successful. We had to invest in how we were organized. This was the digital team. We were organized around kind of political organizers at the middle, if you like, surrounded by those professionals who were creating the content that was so powerful. And one of the things that's really important for me is, as a political campaigner with the different parties that we work with, that often the temptation is to hire within, to hire people who have the most loyalty to the party, people who have been effective ombudsman in AOF or wherever else it might be. We went out and found the best people in the business. The people who worked on our video team used to work at CNN. They used to make documentaries. The people on our design team used to work at Nike. We hired those people who were good at getting the job done rather than the people who were particularly political. And we tried to use digital platforms across the entire campaign. not just in our own world, but trying to work with the research and the policy team to explain fairly detailed and nuanced issues in a very clear way. This is a graph of jobs growth in America that really helped people to see how the president had helped the country recover from the greatest economic crash since the Great Depression and turn the corner. We tried to use a video to help the communications team get their message across, partly to journalists, but also to the members of the public. This is Stephanie Cutter, the deputy campaign manager, who became quite a sensation with short, snappy, direct-to-camera videos responding to some of the attacks that the Romney campaign and his allies made. And as you can see here, this kind of video getting 800,000 views, I think, is very telling about how people consume their information. And I'm going to show a video for a second, so you can look at something rather than listen to me, that really tells a story, or it shows you how we use digital to tell a story that helped our field operation. Our people out on the doors, knocking on doors and communicating with voters face-to-face. I think it's a really good example of how digital helped them to do their job.
We're out here trying to get people to come out and volunteer to help the president get re-elected in the fall. Are you interested? See you soon.
Neighborhood team leader. We're training people how to canvas. They see the blue 2012 and it's game over.
Nah, man, you got this. Go for it.
Hello.
Nice meeting you.
Yeah.
I want to give incentives to companies that are investing in you, the American people, to create American jobs, making American goods.
Until November, we need you all to get out there and tell everybody you know, tell them about Barack's values.
Thank you.
I really love that video for a couple of reasons. The first one is it really speaks to the role of digital in amplifying and supporting every other aspect of the campaign. It's a great way of showing what being in the field looks like and why it is a big role. The other thing I love about that video is, you remember the bit about halfway through shaking hands with Michelle Obama? A colleague in the video team who made that video from a point of view shot actually made his own thing. It was like a motorcycle helmet with a scaffolding strapped to, so the camera is literally strapped to his face. And I just love how cool Michelle Obama was about being presented with this guy with a video camera strapped to his face. You wouldn't have been able to tell that from the way she looked. Very cool. And so the role of digital was to support everyone, and everyone's job was digital. The second thing is about, you know, when we talk about social media and making things social, we think about the tools, we think about the tactics, we think Facebook and Tumblr and Twitter, Pinterest if you're particularly sad. All of these tools, we think about the tools. But actually, that's not what we were primarily thinking on the campaign. We were thinking of community. We were thinking of the real relationships that people have in their communities, the real conversations that they have, and the interactions that they have with their neighbors and their friends and with each other. And then we were thinking about the tools that could help narrate that. You can't build an app for relationships. You can't create something and hope they come. You have to look at real conversations and think about ways in which the campaign can be a part of those and make them efficient and effective and useful to the campaign, but it has to be about the community first. There are ways in which you can effectively take part in those relationships, though, and help those relationships be meaningful to the campaign. It was a great piece of technology that the campaign built during the summer of 2012 called targeted sharing. We allowed people to log into the website through their Facebook account, and it gave them a chance to share information with us that allowed us to identify their friends that they had on Facebook who might not be registered to vote or might be particularly interested in a specific issue, and gave them a chance of contacting those people. You know, we had a target group of under 35s, 50% of those people, we had no way of contacting them at all. I had no phone number, no email address, no postal address. But of that 50%, 85% of those people were friends with a friend of Barack Obama on Facebook. And so we could go to those friends and say, hey, you have these four friends. They're not registered to vote. Can you give them an easy way of finding out how to sign up? And so we were taking part in supporting people in their relationships in ways that could be meaningful to us. The third thing is, making it very easy for people. I kind of always feel a bit stupid putting slides like this up on a screen. It's kind of, well, you know, duh, make it easy for people. It's kind of obvious. But actually, if we take a look at the kind of tools that we have on our websites, the kind of, you know, mechanisms for finding out information, they're often not that easy. They're often barriers that are thrown up, either through our lack of investment or through our focus on internal audiences rather than our audiences that we're trying to reach. So we tried to make it really easy. The team tried to make things like finding where you could vote easy. You could just punch in your postal code to the website and get a really easy way of finding out where to vote with directions and everything else like that. Compare that to the Romney campaign, who I try not to constantly pick on, but this is a particularly bad example of their work. You know, the difference between the two things isn't just aesthetic, it isn't just being a bit cooler. Those are real votes that we're getting and real votes they're not getting as a result of that user experience. Try to make it easy to give for people to give us money. Obviously hugely important in a US election, but will be increasingly important in elections in this country and important in other sectors of business. And so we tried to make it very easy for people. Of people who came to our website and clicked on a button that said donate, I would like to donate, 70% of those people didn't complete the transaction. They were on the page and they, you know, got bored, or their, you know, girlfriend came home, or something came on the TV, whatever else it might be. Even people who said they were willing to donate to us, they clicked on a button, they were ready to go. 70% of those people didn't complete the transaction. So we had a tool called Quick Donate. People could save their card payment information with us, and next time they came back to the site, they didn't have to put in their card information. They could just hit $15, and their money was taken. A way of giving in the same way by SMS. Just reply with the amount to give through your saved credit card, $10. That wasn't me. I gave much more than $10. But a way of making it very, very easy to give. That actually, the difference between having Quick Donate and not having Quick Donate to us on the campaign was estimated at around $60 million. You know, that in American elections, that's almost real money. So, you know, making it easy for people to take part in what you're doing is really, really important. And then a third example, which is another video, a shorter one, but important, because making it easy isn't just about the functionality of being easy. It's also about making it easy in a relationship sense. If you're asking someone to post something from to Facebook for you, if it's boring, they're either not going to do it, or they're going to think worse of you for asking to do it in the first place. And so we tried to create content that was very shareable, very interesting, either aesthetically beautiful or had a sense of emotion and inclusion, or in this instance, something that we thought people would share because it was quite amusing.
As governor, I cut taxes 19 times and didn't raise taxes.
He called them fees. I'm sure the people that had to pay it, well, they called them bananas, so he still had to pay extra.
It's funny, that was a good video for the moment to get our message across. It was very shared, but also throughout my entire life, I've had the ambition of working on a campaign that used can-can music in a video, so I got that to tick that off my to-do list before I die. So that's great content. People enjoyed it, but we were in that content communicating 1,310 taxes and fees that Mitt Romney put up while he was governor of Massachusetts. We could have done that in a much boring way. And it's important to give people an incentive to share it with friends that isn't just, it's my duty to you. You know, great content makes a difference between someone clicking or not clicking. And without great content, you know, a big discussion has come up after the campaign about big data and the role of data in how we campaign. But without great content, data doesn't really help. Having great data to guide you through how best to use something that's incredibly boring is not going to get you that far. But it really, really, really helps. To have great data really, really helps. And so there's an art and a science to digital campaigning. The art is having people with a creative nous to come up with beautiful phrases in emails, to come up with beautiful images to post on Facebook, to have the idea that we should be asking people to do something specific around a specific moment. And so you have to have people that are great at writing. But having data allows you to be guided as to what will work and what won't work with your supporters. This is an example on the screen from one use of data that I particularly like. It was an email that the email team, my colleagues in the email team, sent out during a particularly tough fundraising period. We were being outraised by Mitt Romney several months in a row. It was a huge concern. Being outspent in a presidential election is not a good place to be. And we were trying to test a few different ways of asking for people to step up before the end of quarter fundraising deadline. The email team sent out 18 different emails to a very small slice of the list that we had. Each email was from a different person or had a different subject line or maybe had some different content. And the small slice of the email list they sent their each of these tests to gave us back data that we used to extrapolate and understand what would be the result if we sent it to the entire list. In campaigns in the past, sometimes you would not even try these tests. Sometimes you would write several emails and you would guess. Sometimes the communications team would say, I'm not sure about that one, it sounds a bit funny. You know, one of these emails was from Barack Obama with the subject line, I will be outspent. Maybe 10 years ago, the press team might have felt like that's made him sound weak, didn't project the kind of image that we were trying to project. But from these tests, what the team found was the worst performing email versus Barack Obama, I will be outspent, the difference was $2.1 million. And so using data to be guided about some of those intuitions and instincts that we had, knowing what content to use when, what language to use when, in real time, almost real time, was worth real money to us. But it also gave us a chance to be more respectful of our audience because we were trying to find out what we thought that they were going to enjoy. And so we were communicating with them in personalized ways in which we knew they would respond to positively. That was good for us, but also good for them. The fifth thing I want to mention is something that is a difficult conversation to have with political campaigns. I don't want to be critical, because some of my best friends are politicians. But on the whole, sometimes people in politics don't communicate necessarily in ways that are normal. We use different phrases, maybe. You can see I'm trying to tiptoe around this. But we are sometimes not very comfortable. We use jargon. We use language that is most interesting in parliamentary committees than in pubs and bars. And we don't engage with people in a fun, amusing way. You know, it's important to always remember in a political campaign that you have your mission, win the election, raise money, get out people to volunteer. But it has to be part of a relationship that you have with people. You have to be respectful of the relationship you have. And that means not being lame. That means not disrespecting people by sending gimmicks. It means not disrespecting people by being boring. It means giving them content that they want. We tried a really big range of content. We tried to be we tried to make things aesthetically beautiful. But we also listened to people through the data to understand whether or not they were engaging with what we were sending. So when we were trying infographics or quotes or image macros, we looked at whether people were interested. If they weren't interested in it, we stopped doing it. One of the powerful things about digital is that it allows you to fail fast. And to us, failing meant people not engaging with us. So we tried to be personable. We tried to give people a sense of who the president was, reacting in a kind of geeky way to a science fair experiment, for example, or perhaps being somewhat lighthearted about a quite incredible moment in the campaign when Clint Eastwood had a debate with an empty chair. I should have had an empty chair up here. That would have been a much better joke. I'll try that next time. So we try to always be respectful of people and include them in the relationship that we were trying to build. I want to say one last thing before we wrap up and have some questions. The important thing about the Obama campaign, for all of its incredible results and all of the incredible support that we got and generated, none of it happens without an incredible amount of investment. The digital team on the Obama campaign had 300 people. You don't need 300 people in every organization to make digital work, but you need to invest. You need to invest organizationally in having more people and people with the skills, but you also need to invest structurally, putting the digital people in senior levels where they are listened to and are able to influence decisions rather than just being at the end of a conveyor belt waiting for instructions from on high. And that is a challenge for all of us. It's a challenge for political parties in particular who have historically, over the last 10 years, failed to invest in a digital program, both from a capacity staff point of view, but also from a political, structural point of view. It's a big challenge. But those organizations and political parties that continue to fail will fall back. And those organizations that take the challenge and dare to invest will move forward. So those are my lessons from the campaign. I think we're going to take some questions.
Like to ask two questions, which is always a risk that I won't get the first one answered, right? Would this campaign of 08, was this 08 or 12?
This is from 12. I didn't work on 12. The 08
campaign. Oh, okay. Would they be very different if it was Hillary Clinton? That's number one. And how much influence did actually Obama have on the way these things were run?
Yeah. So I take each question one at a time? Yeah, great. So I'm going to focus on your second question a little bit more. to take your first question, I think that Hillary's been she was a phenomenal Secretary of State, and I think an incredible job, and I personally hope that she runs in 2016. I have no inside information on that, obviously, but I hope she does. The thing that is really important to me about both 2008 and 2012 is that, you know, we implemented great digital tactics. You know, my colleague Laura, I think, ran one of the best campaign tumblers ever. We had an incredible Twitter feed. We were great on Facebook. The videos we made were phenomenal. But all of that was under an ethos of community organizing. We were a campaign that took community organizing really seriously, and the work we did online was an attempt to make that community organizing happen. And that sense of community organizing as a campaign came from the president. And so the entire ethos of our organization, the way in which we structured ourselves, the approach we took, the culture of the campaign came from the president. And I think his background as a community organizer is a hugely important point. You know, there's a video of the president talking the day after the election in head office. He's saying thank you to staff. You can see me right at the back because I'm wearing my yellow Norwich shirt, so I stand out. And he talked about the staff as community organizers. He talked to the staff about the role that they would go on in life to take, not about the money we raised or the size of the email list or anything else like that. He talked about the role of community organizing. And I think that's the biggest influence the big influence that he had, and something we all took really seriously.
Yeah, I have a quick question. I'll try to limit myself from two questions to two tweets instead, because I'm really curious about the two. What was leading up to the two tweets that you showed there? One with a chair for the seats taken tweet, and the four more years tweet, which is kind of bald moves. Coming from a communicative background and studies, which I do, and I wasn't how much work or what processes led to those tweet being tweeted at the moment they were, because they are on Flickr, these images that I've seen, they're posted long before you sent them out in the setting of Twitter. So that's what I'm interested in hearing about.
Sure, and I'll just relay the experience that a colleague, friend, Laura Olin, who was the social media director, explained about the four more years tweet, that there was no thinking ahead. And, they were in the office at 9 p.m. on the central time. Elections were being called across states, and we realized that we were winning. And so they scrambled to find a good picture of the president and the first lady celebrating. And they found a couple of options and sent them to Teddy Goff, our digital director. And he didn't like them, and so they went and looked for a couple more, and they found this picture of the president and the first lady. And they decided there and then, four more years, we've won. That's the moment that we were sharing with our supporters, and they hit tweet. It wasn't actually any more complex than that. And I think that's that speaks to the... you know, the need to have very highly qualified people in this area. You know, Laura and the team that she had working for her on social media were phenomenal, and got a lot of these things right as a result of the experience and expertise that they had, and just kept moving. This seat's taken tweet, I can't remember if I mentioned the context, that this was on the night of the GOP convention. Clint Eastwood was the keynote speaker. He's, I'm sure you know that he's one of the most popular people in the entire country. So it was quite a moment for the Republicans to have Clint Eastwood on TV in front of 60 million people talking about supporting Mitt Romney. But he decided to do that in a fairly strange way, by interviewing the president in an empty chair. I kind of feel stupid even saying that, but it did happen. So that was a kind of incredible moment. Twitter blew up, and everyone was talking about this. And the idea came from, I think, one of my colleagues in the email team. We wanted to say something, but we were obviously never going to criticize Clint Eastwood. The thought was to note the fact that it happened, but to say, we've got this. This seat's taken. We're not going anywhere. And it wasn't any more complicated than a discussion around the room. Both of those moments were really incredible. On that second point, I think it speaks to the willingness of senior staff on the campaign, you know, our bosses, to take risks. You know, it's not a common kind of tweet, this seat's taken, for a political party to take, for a political party to tweet. And I think it speaks to the understanding that senior staff had of digital themselves and the trust that they placed in the people running the digital team. And I think that's a good lesson for organizations across the board.
Yes, thank you for a very interesting lecture. I wondered if you could talk a little bit about what kind of political attacks from the Romney campaign were the hardest to fight back in the digital media for you?
I think I've probably put them all out of my mind. Everything we did went perfectly well and smoothly, so I don't know how to. No, I'm only joking. The most challenging time, I think, for on the response side was after the first debate, I don't know if people know, but it didn't go brilliantly for us. On one hand, the president himself has said that it didn't go well, so I'm not talking out of turn. I think he was a little off his game, but also. Mitt Romney adopted a strategy of lying his way through the debate in quite an incredible way. He said that he didn't have a tax plan to cut taxes for the rich. We had him on tape saying, "I will cut taxes for the top 1%. It was a kind of incredible moment. It felt like an out-of-body experience watching him say these things. But obviously the next few days were very difficult for us. And the challenge in those moments is to find new topics to talk about, to get back onto the things that you want to talk about in the election. You know, one of the ways in which we did that was to focus on Romney's commitment to cut PBS, Public Service Broadcasting in America, who makes Sesame Street with Big Bird. We were trying to communicate the message that Mitt Romney will cut services in this country. He will cut back on the things that are important, the investments that we need to keep the country growing, while at the same time raising taxes, cutting taxes on millionaires and billionaires. Big Bird was an ally for us in that fight back. But it was a very tough few days. The momentum slipped away for a moment, and a lot of the air went out from under our feet, because at that moment we felt very confident about how things were going. So it was obviously a very difficult moment. One other interesting thing, as you've mentioned it, to share, is that Romney had talked in that way about Big Bird dozens of times before. Dozens of times. I watched every speech he gave in the primaries. He said it every speech. He constantly referred to it. It got a laugh and an applause round in the primary speeches that he gave earlier in the year. But really, even in American elections, with the TV and the glamour and everything else, people aren't really paying attention that far out. And so Romney kind of walked into a statement that we were able to turn back on him, despite having said it dozens of times before. And I think that was a really interesting lesson for us.
Hi. You mentioned that this was a very expensive campaign, more than $1 billion.
$1 billion.
$1 billion were spent. And if you think about, there's an election coming up in Norway, and if you have 10 communication people in your staff and you just have a tiny share of those money, what are the lessons to be learned from the Obama campaign?
I think the slightly general and unhelpful answer is to think about the principles that underpinned the work that we were doing. From a digital rapid response point of view, we were trying to create content that would help us push back in the media with journalists on that specific issue. Journalists consume digital content just like everyone else, and so we were trying to get our facts out as quickly as we could to affect the way that the news story, the story was being reported by journalists. But we were also trying to create content that our supporters could use in the conversations that they had at work, at church, wherever they might be. Because to us, the 27 million people on Twitter was a megaphone that we could use to communicate our message, in the same way that CNN was a megaphone that we could use to communicate our message. So I think the big thing for me is that wherever you are, however many people you've got in your team, society is changing in a way that makes it much more important to invest in your supporters and the people that can be that megaphone for you in the country. Now, you might not have 27 million people on Twitter, it might be 200,000, but those people are still an important voice for you, not just because of their numbers, but because they are more believable than the TV. You hear some facts about Mitt Romney's tax plan from somebody that you play football with every other week. You're going to believe that much more than you will if you see it in a TV ad or a newspaper article. And so I think that principle of mobilizing your supporters works whatever the scale is. I think the other thing is we tried really hard to make sure that people were getting the facts. We had a phenomenal research team who gave us the tools that we needed to communicate the facts to people. I think that also works wherever you are. People don't want to listen to politicians' views. They want to know what the facts are. And I think that's another really important thing. I think we've got time for one more before we wrap up. It has to be a quick one. So we've got time for half an answer. Can we make this one about Norwich City?
You've talked a lot about how you use social media for, getting your message out there. But have you used social media strategically to, communicate and get your voters' opinions into your campaigns?
Yep. I would say two quick things. The first one is that social media is important, but email is absolutely the most important tool that we had on the campaign. Email is not dead. Email is very, very essential to driving action. It's the fire hose of action from a supporter base. And so social media is important, but email is absolutely central, and we shouldn't lose sight of that. The second thing is that we used social media to listen to people. We read comments. We responded to people. But really, the way in which we listened to people most was in offline events. We made sure that we weren't just communicating with people online. They don't only live online, they also live offline. So, house parties and watch parties for the debates and offices and so on. Listening to people in the real world as well. So I think we need to wrap up there. Thank you very much for inviting me and all the best.